What's going on, people? Welcome back to Curtis Shaw TV, back with another live stream. Special guest in the building, needs no introduction as always. If you ain't subscribed to him already, what are you doing? Deluded in the cut, what are you saying, my bro?
Oh, good, man. You always throw me off when you do that, you know? All these times we've been there, that you always get me with that, you know? Always fall for it, but I'm good, man.
You know what I mean? The link-up is essential, bro, I'm telling you.
Trust me. Needed, man. Yeah. I'm happy to be back, man. Appreciate you for letting me come on again as every time, man.
Yeah, man. What you been up to on your own channel?
Same old stuff, isn't it? The same old stuff we're talking about. I just finished a live stream, more general sort of football, speaking about the Premier League, but literally the same old stuff that you're probably covering, really, you know, is with this Arsenal news and whatnot. It's a bit of a slow week.
Yeah. Oh, Cedric here. Apologies, man. I don't know. The mods, they must have seen you saying something a bit crazy, man. But you're back anyway. So, you know, keep it moving, you know. We have to live and learn in life sometimes, you know. But no, listen. We're back, man. Arsenal. I'm trying to think. When's the last time I had you on? I think it was after the Wolves game. We was talking about David Luiz. Since then, we've played what? We played Villa, lost to Villa, and we beat, obviously, beat Leeds at the weekend. What have you made? Briefly, what did you make of the Villa game? And then, obviously, we'll look at the Leeds game a little bit.
I think we spoke about Villa, you know.
Did we speak about Villa?
I think we spoke about Villa still. I must have been on this after Villa, man. I'm sure.
Maybe. All right, we'll talk. What about the Leeds game then? What do you think of the Leeds game?
Leeds game, bro, what can I say? It's wavy. We won, innit? End of the day, we won. All right, wait, man, wait, cut the chat before I carry on. I see that. What are we saying?
I see that one there.
Advertising. You're asking me a question right now.
You got to plug yourself shamelessly in this thing. I'm telling you, man.
I see that. I was thinking he's grabbing his tea. I was like, oh, then I see a logo in that. My God. But yeah, anyways, man. The Leeds thing, obviously, we won, innit? What can I say? I'm ecstatic that we won. We needed 3 points. We've been dropping points. I'm happy because I like to see the thing that impressed me the most, beyond the obvious, the Aubameyang hat-trick, you know, Odegaard looked all right and all the other stuff, was depressing, because I'm inclined to believe you worked on something, Arteta and the boys, in relation to how you're going to press Leeds. And I think we pressed them superbly. We pressed them into their own mistakes, really and truly. And we killed them, you know. Very early on, we scored the goal. So what can I say? Bit disappointed, the two goals we conceded. Bit cheap goals in line with what we're doing. But you can't have it all, bro. 3 points. Live to fight another day, man.
That's it. Man.
It's expected. I just wish I had a pound for every time.
There it is, man. No, I agree with you, though, man. I thought it was interesting because Bielsa said after the game that Arsenal prepared for the game better than Leeds. He said they had a plan that he didn't expect. So I like that. Yeah, it was he probably didn't expect us to press so hard like that. But like you said, I was a little bit disappointed that we conceded two goals, because when you think about Benfica, Man City, Leicester coming up, you can't switch off like that. At 4-0, I'm thinking this is going to be 5 or 6-0. All of a sudden, 4-2. If Bamford gets that penalty, 4-3, anything can happen. So I think we've got to learn how to manage games better.
You said it yourself, bro. You know, it's the age-old thing. A theme of us, as we know, we speak about on your channel and mine, is cheap goals. Very rarely do we sit up and applaud another team and say, without sounding negative, and say, oh, what a goal that was. You know, the one you could probably think of is João Moutinho. We just keep defeating ourselves in that regards. Like, Leeds historically haven't been too prolific from set pieces this season. And we were all speaking about it going into the game. Lo and behold, we've conceded. We switched off in that regards. The second goal is a case of not following runners. So you're right, man. You made a fantastic point. And that kind of went over my head in that you've got Leeds, Benfica, City, you know, you can't really afford to keep giving them leeway. I do think, I forgot to mention, I have to shout out Ceballos as well for his performance. I think he played well. And I don't understand the VAR law. I don't, you know, Saka's a quality player, but he should have had two penalties literally the day before. I don't understand how the Højbjerg one's given and our thing isn't given, but fair play.
Do you know what was interesting today? Wayne Rooney's done an interview on Sky today saying that VAR should be scrapped. And he says a lot of top Premier League players who he speaks to are saying they want it out of the game. Do you think VAR should be scrapped, or do you think they've got to try to manage it better? What's your thoughts?
It's probably sounding like man that didn't want the internet when it was probably sounding, you know. My beef is not with them. Yeah, yeah. I'm, it's adapt or survive. I'm obviously, you know, my I'm not a biggest fan of VAR, really and truly. I like the controversy that comes with football, but you know, we're trying to get the right decision, so I'm all for it. My problem is not VAR and the system. My problem is how it's being implemented specifically as well in this country. If you get that spot on, then who doesn't want the right decisions? Because let's be real, I know VAR has been ruining Arsenal and stuff, but I'm pretty sure this season there must have been times we've conceded a goal or something's gone against us and it's patterned us. So it's just the people that implement it, you know. I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure there was stuff online saying, you see the person who controlled VAR in the Leeds game.
Yeah,
it's the same. Allegedly, it was the same official who got what's his name, Alex Oxlade-Chamberlain and Kieran Gibbs mixed up. So I think that's if that is true, that speaks to levels of the incompetence, man. I hear what Rooney's saying. If the professionals aren't for it, but who doesn't want the right decisions? Like, you lose the controversy, but I want the right decisions, man. It's just how we're using this thing.
It's crazy, man. Like, I remember when it was in the Champions League at the start, and I thought, it don't look too bad in the Champions League. They're making decisions pretty quick. They're getting most of them right. It's come in the Premier League, and it's a shambles. Like, me and you, we used to go to the Emirates a lot, watch the Arsenal games. It got to the point where when we scored...
You don't celebrate.
I couldn't celebrate properly, brother. I just thought, goal. Now, let me look at the screen and see what happens. Like, it was mad, bruv. Like, they've got to do something about it, aren't they? Because it's definitely, you know, as a watching fan, I know the fact Arsenal haven't been that great this season, but I think football is not the same as it used to be to me at the moment. Obviously, no fans, but I don't think we're using VAR very well over it.
We're not using it very well at all, man. And again, for me, it's fundamentally how we implement it and the individuals behind it. It's like 9 times out of 10, people are not preying what referee is controlling VAR. You know, referee, if we was to, again, I have no evidence to support this, but I'm pretty sure if you was to get statistics behind competent decisions regarding the top 5 leagues, I'm not too sure England would score very high. So you can't have these individuals trying to control this elite system. You need to either retrain these individuals so that they are competent and can make the right decisions quickly and effectively, or bring in some people who can. Because you look at, I know VAR isn't the same as Hawkeye and stuff, but you know, we need to be aspiring to have it like that. You know, like you said, with the other leagues, it does, I'm sure fans of other leagues would probably say different in some regards, but with other leagues and other tournaments, it looks like it's implemented all the processes that goes behind it 10 times better. It seems in England, it's just our way or the highway. And our way is not good. It's not good. Like you said, you can't even celebrate, you know. And we've been at the Emirates, unfortunately, where we thought we've got back in a game. We're celebrating. You look to that board and you see them, that purple writing, and you know it's over.
That's it's crazy. Long. It's long. It ruins it, bro. It's mad.
Mad.
Moving on, I don't know if you've seen this story that's come out today about Aubameyang and
the COVID thing.
Yeah, like sometimes I think to myself, you know, what are these footballers thinking? I mean, it's bad enough that you got the tattoo and you're not supposed to. Cool, I get that. You shouldn't be doing that anyway. But why are you posting it on social media for everyone to see? I don't understand. And now they're talking about the FA could get involved. They're saying could even potentially be a ban for him. I mean, what do you make of Aubameyang doing that?
Well, someone kind of put it to me in the live stream when I was doing it, and I didn't have really that long to look at the facts. But when I look at it, you know, the first thing I thought of, when was it? You know, because when something's posted and when something's recorded are obviously two different things. And from what I look at, it was I could be wrong, but it was the guy who had, it wasn't Aubameyang specifically. It was the Donny. I could be wrong, but obviously in simple things, you don't do these things. You don't take these risks, granted leave or not. We don't speak about it, and it puts you in contempt. And I guess Arsenal have a decision to make. You know, they will probably fine him, and whatever the FA allegedly do, they allegedly do and get away with. But it doesn't look good at us, because when you add this in, I'm sure Lacazette and Pepe had their little rumblings. Obviously, he's the captain. It doesn't look good. And again, if I'm any of the players, if there is anything that it goes further, then I'm keen to see if Aubameyang gets the same energy that some others in terms of sanctions. But, you know, the tattoo artist, like he said, he's an idiot. But the tattoo artist wins in it, with all regards. Let's be real. I'm not defending him, but he wants to say, I tattooed Aubameyang, come to my shop. It is the game.
Yeah. You know, it's like that. That's massive promotion for him. I was looking at, I think, Kyle Walker. He had a party during lockdown. And
he's a mad youth, man. He was doing stuff.
Grealish was drink driving, smashing cars, and I'm pretty sure he didn't get a ban
smashing
from the
end. Yell as well, taking pictures with them. I'm sure we all saw them.
You know what I mean? So, listen, for me, as far as I'm concerned, the FA, it's nothing to do with them. You know, Arsenal, give him his little fine and just keep it moving. I don't see any reason to ban him from the team. So, little stupid from him there, but hey, we all make mistakes, man. Moving forward, obviously, I wanted to get into this this potential transfer news. Odsonne Edouard, this story's come out saying that he could be available for just £15 million this summer. His agent saying that he's refused to sign any new contract with Celtic and that he only has a year left this summer. Celtic are in, is saying they're in a little bit of financial difficulty because of the pandemic. Would you be keen on him for £15 million, 23 years of age now?
I mean, like you said, man, there's a bunch of reasons as to why Celtic might, you put it right, why Celtic might sell. I would have a look at him. It all probably depends on what we do with the two strikers at our club. I actually watched the game at the weekend where he actually scored. He scored. I like his movement. I like his play. I'll be honest, I'm still waiting on that little, I like him if he came to our club, be cool, but I'm waiting on that real thing to read. I can't put a word on it, but that real single point to convince me. He is a good player, and you could do a lot worse for 15 million, really and truly. You really could. And you know, you never know. You do have to take a chance on these sort of players that people are oohing and aahing about. Look at Liverpool. There was a time people oohed and aahed over Salah and Mane. Now look what they did. I'm not saying he's gonna be that, but we've made more expensive gambles in it. Like, you know, you've committed certain players on big year deals on free transfer, so you could do no worse. I would have a look.
I'm kind of the same with you. I've watched him a few times. He does get goals. I don't know. I don't know if I'm being snobby, but I don't have a wow factor when I watch him. I see a competent goal scorer with good movement. Maybe he can develop and become a top player, but I'm still not sure how good he is, to be honest.
Do you know what it is for me? It's I think like that, but if the board are going to go for him for what you see he could be. You know, he is 23. These strikers are weird ones. You're a striker yourself, so you know, you sometimes you might look at a striker 1 year, he's not really at it. You look at him another year. Like, I remember the under-20s World Cup where Haaland ripped at it, and Martinez is now at Inter Milan. He looked a bit iffy. So sometimes you have to just take a chance on people. And for me, fundamentally, you could do a lot worse, and you'd like to imagine... If it did go terrible, you can make a 15 back, even by Arsenal standards. Yeah. Sure, you can make that 15 back. You could, assuming it is that, you could do a lot worse. So I'd all be for it. But it's for me, if you're going to sign him, what do you see him being in 3-4 years? Don't just sign him because he's got a year left and he's one that a name throws up and things like that. Get him because you really want him and you see what he could be. Because I see some games he goes a bit missing. Some games you see technical level. I'm still... really fully yet to be convinced. Like, I'm 60, 70, really.
Yeah. I mean, when you look at, just wanted to look here, obviously, at his stats and that. He's got, 15 goals? He scores goals, don't he? I mean, he got 30 in all comps last year, 22 in the league. He even scored goals in the Champions League and Europa League as well. Just turned 23.
But he's a good player still.
I think the thing is, bro, when you look at, I mean, Lacazette got 10 league goals last season. I feel like this kid can get 10 league goals at least just because of his movement alone and his...
Yeah, he's got good movement.
Yeah, he's got good movement. He's 23.
He's very good technically.
Yeah. He's a French under-21 player. I mean, he played with Guendouzi. I mean, he's got 9 goals in 6 games for the under-21s. I would probably take the gamble on him. I mean, people are saying sell Lacazette to get him. You could probably actually sell Eddie and Nketiah to get him if he's going to be £15 million.
Really and truly, yeah, you should be able to minimum sell Eddie and Nketiah for a similar sum, really and truly, and that makes it for yourself. Like you said, he's got good movement. He's technically good. I like his personality. Like, you know, Celtic were behind at the weekend and he took it in his stride to get them back in the team. So these sort of things, and like somebody said here, I'm sure Tini will have something to say about him. You could do a lot worse, man. You know, physically, I'd say his stature is deceiving. He's tall, but he doesn't look the most muscly of character, but he can hold up the ball relatively well. He can play a couple of roles. It's up to the, there's got to be a reason as to why people haven't moved. But for me, I just care about if we've done our due diligence on the player. You know, you look at Jota at the time. Again, he's injured at the moment, but people probably looked at that. Nah, all right, signing for Liverpool, it probably wasn't wow. But then you see what he was doing prior to his injury. And then you hear the way Klopp spoke about him. I've been looking at him for a year. I saw not just how good he is now, but what he can be and how he can tie in allegedly to the future. That's what we have to do.
It's an interesting one because I feel like we've got a bit of a striker conundrum now because you look at Aubameyang against Leeds. I know that's a one-off game, but you look at it and you think if you get him facing up defenders, you get service to him. I feel like earlier in the season when he was playing up front, you know, we had a bit of a static midfield. Now you've got
Smith.
Do you know what I'm saying? He looks to me now like he could be the striker at Arsenal if we play a certain way to suit him. Obviously, you've got the Balogun situation, Eddie and Lacazette. You've got decisions to make on them. What's your thoughts, first of all, on Aubameyang being our central striker moving forward?
Well, I'm all for it because obviously he's our best striker. My immediate bias is pace and things. You said it perfectly there when you said if you're going to play to his strengths. Now, for me, Aubameyang is one of those footballers. You've got to commit fully to it. Like, if you're going to play to his strengths, there's no half in. We're creating chances. We're doing what we need to do. Are we going to do what we did against Leeds on a game-by-game basis? I'll leave that to the people in the comments to draw conclusions because we've seen reasons to say yes and reasons to say no. We've also got to remember sometimes people are going to set up against that and our we need a plan B. So immediately I'm for it. If that is going to be, I don't think Arteta deep down is convinced on that. But if we're going to create chances, why not? Like, why not? And for me, you made a great point about movement and earlier in the season, sorry. He looks, the movement's better from everybody, but I'm sure you see it yourself because, again, you're a striker, but you see he looks like he knows he's going to get the ball. Like, he's happy. He knows he's going to get it and things like that. Before in the season, he looked down at the dumps. I'm sure you remember Sky Sports even talking about it because you know you're not going to get it. We've all played football. You know when a football goes to someone who is dead and or you know hasn't got that pass or you know isn't going to look towards to playing it to you and you're not really motivated. When you've got Odegaard and Smith Rowe and Saka and these sort of guys, you know, you're going to want it. So if we do it, we need to commit all in, man.
Do you know what I liked about the game against Leeds? When Aubameyang was drifting out to the left as he does that kind of Thierry Henry movement, and I like the way you would see maybe Smith Rowe drift central or you would see Odegaard go into that position. That whole front four, the interchange of movement, I thought that's so difficult to play against, man. So it's true what you said. You've got it bang on. If they are going to play Aubameyang central, they have to build around him. They have to create properly. And I've always kind of got...
keep pressing from the front. Sorry to cut you off, but you need to do what you did. Press from the front. Press from the front or Aubameyang's useless, really.
Do you think Arteta's convinced by Aubameyang through the middle?
No, like I said earlier, I don't think he fully is. Not that it's any criticism of Aubameyang. I think he loves Aubameyang. I think he's fully convinced of the strengths he gives you. But in relation to what he probably demands from an out-and-out striker game by game, or if you put a gun to Arteta's head and said, if you lose this game, you're going to lose your life. I don't really think he's convinced with Aubameyang through the middle necessarily. I do think he would look to go for a striker. And you said it yourself, we're in a striker conundrum. You know, even today, there's talk of Lacazette and Eddie Nketiah were open to selling them, which could promote Balogun. You know, like my man said here, in an ideal world, you know, that could be a perfect scenario. I'm sure people don't want to sell Laka, but if you could get decent fees for them to bring in Edouard for this 15 million, give Balogun a chance, commit his deal or even loan him out, then it looks like a decent bit of business. Because I'd even say, what's it, you could have Edegaard, Aubameyang and, you know, Martinelli. I'd love to see Martinelli get a chance through the middle. We always forget about him in these striker shouts.
I totally agree, man. Aubameyang, Edouard and Balogun as our three strikers next year. I would have no problem with that, you know. Get a 15 million for Eddie, get maybe 20 for Lacazette. Buy Edouard for 15 to 20 and give Balogun a new contract. You've got a 23-year-old there. You've got Balogun, who's what, a teenager, you know, upcoming youngster, give him a chance. And then Aubameyang as the older one. I think that would give us much better balance if we did that.
And I think they'd all compliment, like I wouldn't say Edouard's known for his hold-up play, but he can hold the ball up and he does have different strengths to Aubameyang. That's why whatever striker does come into the team, I know you can't have everything, but I'd love to have hold-up play. I'd love him to be able to do kind of what Lacazette's done, people, because I do think people use that as a stick to praise Laka over the top at times with, as much as I love him, because we haven't really got that.
Yeah, I mean, I get into little situations with Lacazette where I've always liked him as a player. He gives everything and all that. But then, like you said, should I be praising a player for giving everything? And, you know, I kind of think with Lacazette, we've just got to call it what it is. We paid £50 million for him. We wanted an upgrade on the amount of goals that Giroud was getting.
Where levels?
Lacazette hasn't done that. You know, Lacazette some years actually getting less than Giroud was getting. I think ultimately, if we be honest, you know, Lacazette scored some big goals, but for the price we paid for him at that time, I would say Lacazette has not been not been a success at Arsenal. What do you think?
I mean, it's a cagey one, really and truly. It's one of those where, let's be honest, he hasn't hit expectations. He hasn't, you know, I'd argue even the man behind you, I'd argue Aubameyang probably wouldn't be there for Aubameyang. I mean, if Lacazette was that 20-goal striker. Yeah. I don't think he's quite measured expectations, and he showed why there's kind of been a reluctance, because we were linked with him for like a three-year period, and it's like, will he, won't he? We big up Tyrese John-Jules, of course. And then we finally jumped in. So he hasn't, but he's still been a good player. You know, 1 year he got our player this season. You know, it's a catch-22. It's like you said, I shouldn't really be praising man for work rate, for putting themselves around, for link-up play and all of this. You're £50 million France international. These are givens, but we haven't seen a return. Decent player. Tricky one. And it's sad that he's laughing, but when you look at it on adapting, it's a bit mad. It's a bit mad still. But he's been a good player, and he still is a good player. I think he's underappreciated his strengths in the squad, man.
I think he's one of them players that, like, the players playing around him probably appreciate him, you know? He works hard. He links up play well. It's just ultimately what we needed him for. He hasn't ticked that box. And I think, like you said, you know, we made offers for him once or twice. Clearly, Wenger was never sure whether to buy him or not.
I'd say he wasn't convinced.
He wasn't convinced. And I think it just became a case of, we need a striker. Who's available? He was available. We'll do it. And like you said, 6 weeks later, we went and bought Aubameyang for even more money. You don't buy a 50 million striker in the summer and then go and buy an even more expensive one in January if you're convinced by the first one. And even Wenger, I remember, used to take Lacazette off every single day.
Yeah.
60, 70 minutes, get him off. Giroud was on. So,
But on that point, yeah, do you not remember when Wenger had us Arsenal fans moving mad? I remember Arsenal fans used to come with some statistics of the most goals scored within the last 10 minutes of games and used to say, Wenger shouldn't take Lacazette off because of that.
No, it's true, because I remember they were saying in France how many goals he scores and that in the last 10, 15. But yeah, it's a tricky one with Laka, man. He's a good player. I do like him. But, you know, looking here, 14, 13 and 10 in three seasons, it's not enough, man. His Burnley striker's getting 10 goals. You know what I mean? Chris Wood probably gets 10 goals at Burnley, bro. You know what I mean? So I think in that sense, he hasn't answered that question. Next subject I want to touch on, really, bruv, is David Luiz. Now, I'm sure you reported this on your channel as well. A lot of people were very disgruntled about this story yesterday. It's come out today that it's actually potentially a player coaching role with a reduced wage as well. Looking out from that point of view, could you get your head around that, or do you just look at it as, look, man, he's 34 this year. He's 34 in April. Is it time to wash our hands with him and get him out the door, or do you mind him being here as a squad player and maybe doing coaching as well?
I'm all for that if we learn our lessons, because, listen, the way you've rationalised that, the way it said, it makes sense, you know. He's a big character. All the young players speak how good he is. He has got character. I would get rid of him, but I hear that if he's going to play a marginalised role. If we learn our lesson from Koscielny, because do you remember, like, Koscielny's last season, to the point where he criticised Emery? When we have these sort of players, we don't marginalise them. You know, let him play Europa League with the young players. We'll let him play. We'll put ourselves in a position where we need to rely on him for 20, 30 games, which is dangerous. You know, as much as I love Aubameyang, you know, Aubameyang's a bit of an exception, but Aubameyang, David Luiz, these likes, if they're going to be part of this squad, it has to be a secondary part, and only that because of their age, within reason. I'm not for it. I don't mind a player coaching role, but I'm not really for it, man. And it further clouds what we're doing at centre-half. Like, I would like to know, is Saliba coming back? Are we moving for another centre-half? I don't mind him coaching and all of that stuff if he is signing reduced things, but I would just like to move him on, really and truly. I think that's what needs to happen. It's too cosy. Thanks for the service, but come on now.
No, I swear, Dan, the word you've just used there, cosy, is exactly what it is. It's like, oh, you know, mate, don't worry. I'll get you something.
You don't want to go.
Yeah, no, you know what I mean? You're a good, I know you're not a good enough player anymore, but I'll get you a little coaching job and you can be fourth choice centre back. It's like, come on. Like, we know what Luiz was when we signed him. And, you know, it was a last minute deal. I think we wanted up a Meccano that window. We didn't get it done. We bought Luiz at the end. He's been here 2 years. For £8 million and what David Luiz is, it's kind of done what it says on the tin. He's been decent, but then every four or five games he's going to drop a mistake. I think Arsenal need to just cut the ties with him, if I'm being honest. I think I understand it because Mikel Arteta's saying we lack experience at centre-back. And
I hear that.
I do hear that as well. But then I look at it, I think we'll go and sign an experienced centre-back. You know, I don't think you need to keep David Luiz at the club because you want an experienced defender. And as people are saying there, it's all right being experienced, but if you're making mistakes, that's not the right kind of experience. You know what I mean?
It only matters if you're good. Like,
there you go. Like, and the thing is, I think he will sign a new deal. I can see it happening.
I don't disagree. And the like, it's just what message does that send out? I don't mind it because, as you see with some clubs in the Premier League this season, you know, they've been down to their bare bones and had to rely on some players that would never get rid. Like, I'm sure Liverpool don't regret selling Lovren, but hindsight, how vital could he have been? So by that logic, I don't mind Luiz. And I think that one day, I don't know, it makes me wonder where Arteta is in terms of where the players really see him, because I see that really as David Luiz, a lieutenant, a big character in the dressing room, not a boss or no Pablo Escobar, but his name kind of holds clout. Is Arteta being a bit smart in that I keep him, I kind of got eyes and ears in the dressing room sort of thing. Obviously, you know, if we sign some more South American players, I'm sure people will say he helps him with the blending in process, but it further clouds the lines for me because, yeah, man, you give him a new deal due to inconsistencies. You've got Willian here for the next two minimum.
Yeah.
What are you saying? Like, it's not sounding decent still, I can't lie.
You know, just when you think Arsenal are learning and you're like, come on now, you know, you've got rid of players at the right time. You're now going to commit to David Luiz another one-year deal. I don't see what that does for Arsenal, giving him a new contract. Like, sometimes it's all right to keep an experienced player around. And, you know, they say he is big in the dressing room. But like you said, you're learning from a player that's got mistakes in him. I don't get that one, to be honest. And like you said, I think it's a friend thing. I think Mikel Arteta probably likes him on a personal level. And he's just kind of looking after him. So it's a strange
job. It's like at a job, man. You wonder, is that he's a guy who's probably cool in the office. He livens it up. He makes time go by. Like, Luiz is probably there. And to be fair to Luiz, you do hear, when you see these little sound bites and stories coming out, you do always see his name among the lists of people who, like, galvanized the squad, who got them towards it. When you especially hear with the wage cuts and things like that. So maybe it's that regards, man. But it's not serious.
I'm not gonna lie. I said, "Ooh, Brazilian friends." I'm not gonna lie. Yeah, I'm not gonna lie though. I do understand the importance of having characters in the dressing room.
Hey,
when you look at that Arsenal squad, and you know, I'm just guessing here. I don't know. I don't see that many characters where, like, they would be lively in the dressing room. And, you know, I can imagine David Luiz being a bit of a joker and a bit of a, you know, a character.
He's a family guy. Like, that's, I can see why he is that, because when he was at Chelsea, it's well documented. Like, he used to be the guy to host little parties, get Christmas presents for everyone. He's on the family thing, the sort of gang thing. So I understand that sort of stuff, especially when you've got these young players and things like that. I'm actually more for it than I thought I should be in that regards. But I just feel, it's fundamentally, it's like you said, when called upon, can I put my faith in you? No. So, you know, just give man the coaching job. Just let him do up the coaching job thing then. Like, it is what it is. Retire, do up the coaching job, go somewhere else, come back and do the coaching. Don't do the halfway in and out thing, man. It's not going to help anyone. It's good for him, but not for us.
You know, if I look at this season, I'm just imagining now, if I'm defending David Luiz a little bit, has he not got the credit he deserved this season? Has he actually been one of our best defenders?
To be fair, yeah, man. Yeah, to be fair with you, you know, a lot of the times, like, I'm saying all of this about David Luiz. To be fair, half the time when I'm doing the previews, I'm screaming David Luiz and someone. And it's mainly because of that character, and this screams why we need to really fix up as a football club. When we need, you know, our problem is breaking down low blocks. Half of the time, David Luiz is a centre-half trying to do that. Now I know I should be talking about defending. Even against Leeds, he's trying to move forward. One thing I'll give David Luiz, for all his faults, he's not a coward. Like, he owns up to his mistakes. He tries to set it. I don't mind all of that. The problem is, you know what David Luiz is. You know that mistake's coming. But he has done his thing this season. He has. Fundamentally, there's been bits this season where he's shown you what he's on. You know, he's been great against United. He was a bit booky against Southampton. He was unfortunate to be sent off against Wolves, but we spoke about this on your channel. Fundamentally, he's out of position. So, and to be fair with you, it's not even his fault now. It's like, we know what David Luiz is. He wears his heart on his sleeve. He's 34, will be 35 if he signed this new deal. We know what he is, you know. You have to just take man for what he is. Are you going to accept that he might do this 5-6 mistakes and it costs you points? If so, what can I sit there and say, man? He's done his thing, though. I think all the centre-halves have done it, but it's like what you always say. It's like, he's just one of these players where it's a form thing. Like, it's not, I think he's better than people think, but are you going to do this consistently?
I'm just at a point with Arsenal where I don't want them players at the club where I feel like they're a ticking time bomb. David Luiz is one of them. Granit Xhaka's one of them. Hector Bellerin. You know, as a fan, when you watch them guys play, it's just a matter of time before they make a mistake. You know you can't trust them guys. Luiz will get sent off every season. Granit Xhaka will get sent off. Hector Bellerin will get ripped up by a left winger every now and then, or put
Paul following his runners.
Yeah, exactly, bro. Look at that game the other day is the perfect example. He scores the goal. I'm going, yo, player ratings, I'm going to have to give Bellerin a high rating. And then he switches off and costs us a goal. And you're like, those players have to be removed from the club, in my opinion. Even El Neni, you know. You can't get caught up in the hype of a few decent performances. So I think I can see the thought process behind David Luiz, but for me, take all the sentiment out of it. Get ruthless. These are the players that ultimately have stopped us from qualifying for the Champions League. So get these guys out of the door for me. What would your overall decision be with David Luiz?
He's fundamentally, he's a good guy and whatnot. But, you know, I want players that I know I'm going to get over a 38-game period. So unless it's a real marginalised role, you have to get rid. And what I look at, you made an interesting point about learning off Luiz. I love Bukayo Saka. I'm not drawing out Saka, but nobody speaks about Saka switching off for that goal where he's let the runner go. You know, fair enough, he can't beat him in the air. He shouldn't be marking him anyways. But as a smaller person marking from set pieces, you're told to follow that man and jump into him sort of thing. Put him off.
Yeah, put him off. Yeah.
You know, I like players that sort things out themselves. I'm sure analytically they will go back and everyone who done something, they will see their mistakes. But I want to see players sort them things out. If David Luiz makes these mistakes, how is he going to tell Saka? Because has he even clocked Saka's done that? You know, Saka, if somebody tells Saka, bloody hell, you're a good footballer, but effing wake up and don't ever do that again, Saka might not do that again. And that's no criticism of Saka. That's what we need to do to crave excellence. We should be put the same effort we put into scoring goals should be keeping these clean sheets. And I feel especially sorry for Leno for all his calamities at times, because I don't feel he's been able to keep too many clean sheets. And even Matt Ryan, when he made his debut, like we need clean sheets.
I think you're right. I mean, I look at that Leeds game, and although I was delighted with a win, I came away from it thinking there was no reason to concede a goal in that game. Like, there was just no reason. Leeds didn't even look like scoring. Like, they actually looked like they were there to just get hammered 5 or 6-0. And, you know, we won the game, so we're not going to focus on it too much. But those mistakes and those sloppy goals to concede, and the thing that worried me, we didn't concede a goal and that's it. We've conceded now less. We actually lost control of that game for 20 minutes where it was like, if Leeds get that third goal, all of a sudden...
It's a different game.
They're probably going to equalise. Let's be honest. They were on the ascendancy.
Let's be real. We scored 4 goals and with all due respect, Holding's the one that comes on. So that tells you we're trying to shut up shop. Arguably, the second half, you could say we lost the second half 2-1, bro. Like, you know, I would argue, you know, I'd even say a goal back to the first goal, because from the 13th minute to the 23rd, there was a minute we kind of put our foot off the gas. You could argue when Leeds kind of woke up and, you know, people like Helder Costa went from making a mistake to scoring, we kind of struggled defending in that regards when a team wanted to turn it on. Look at the simple movement from Rafinha. So there's plenty of things to learn from this game. It's the same way when we battered Newcastle. Nobody speaks about these things, but in the first half of that game, we could not break them down. Second half, Steve Bruce tried to do the hero thing and be expansive. Lo and behold, there's space. We're able to score. You know, people, that's the problem. We've won. Nobody wants to talk about it versus Leeds. People just call you negative and these sort of things rather than balanced. But it is what it is, man. Big up Broads in the cut as well, man.
Yeah, man, big up Broads, people. Go and subscribe to his channel. Over 800 of you in here now. Make sure you like and subscribe. Subscribe to Deluded's channel as well. Looking ahead, we've got... I'm not going to look at the Benfica game too much because we'll preview it on your channel later in the week. But
Thursday, people.
Yeah, Thursday. this next 2 weeks really, I think, will decide the direction of our season. Obviously, Benfica the next two Thursdays, Manchester City and Leicester, either side of those two games. We spoke about it before. We're in a position now where we have to prioritise the Europa League. So I'm looking at that Man City game. Are you resting players for that game ahead of the next Thursday second leg, or are you just going full strength for all of those games?
Bray, it's a question I think nobody can answer, and it's one where I'm happy to not be Arteta because I don't think there's necessarily a right option. For me personally, if I'm a professional footballer or I'm a manager, in August, I'm already looking at these periods. Common sense tells you that the games are coming thick and fast. We know we've got problems in our squad, but that's where you need a squad. Each and every one of those players should be relishing it. More so the attacking players, but arguably people, you could, how many players we always talk about now when the lineup's there and we're saying they're unfortunate to be left out. Play your best players. Let's just stand up to be counted. For me, I play our best team in what we can. Let's not be naive. Probably will be some rotation against City, just like when we played them in the league, but it all depends on who is rotated. It all depends, and you know, I don't know if Partey's going to be missing, but I'm missing him. But yeah, I play my best team wherever possible, man. We take it as we go. Obviously, when you see things like Tierney kind of out with mystery injuries and Partey seem not able to play 90 minutes, you're kind of weary. But we can't really afford. We have to take him seriously. You know, there's still a lot of points to play for. I don't know if we're good enough to put all our eggs in the Europa and get to that final. I don't know. Yeah. So I think we have to take both serious, man.
I mean, yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? Because all of a sudden, Kieran Tierney had muscle tightness, apparently, 2 weeks ago. They said he would miss one game. 2 weeks later, he's still not back. Arteta said in the press conference, Tierney was 50-50 for Benfica. Partey is definitely out. Do you think there's a problem with Tierney? He's had a lot of injuries, and I read that he'd had two operations at Celtic before signing for us as well. One of them being a hernia as well, which is quite a big op. What do you make of Tierney and these injuries?
Well, it's the only negative thing you can say on Tierney since he's been at Arsenal. It's like, can we know you can stay fit and rely on you? We know it's been a crazy season for all Premier League teams in terms of fitness, but I would say, again, I'm no genius and I'm no expert, but I would simply say there's clearly something we're not doing in terms of rehab. Again, I'm no genius, but if you know Tierney's had these problems and there's a risk, make sure you manage his load, whether that's correctly paused, whether that's in the week when we're training or at the weekend. So it is a concern, but it's like with Partey. It's like suddenly Partey's always injured and sometimes he's fit, now he's not fit. It screams a bit incompetent, or how we're managing these players is not good enough. Because as you know, me and you could play for, you know, ball. Me and you could be playing for Arsenal and we play on a Sunday. Monday comes, Tuesday, you're doing a more heavier session than me with the boys. I could be doing some gym work and things. So are we doing that right? When I look at him, when I look at someone like Smith Rowe, are we managing these boys in the week? I'd say no. It also evidently screams, Curtis, that, you know, once again, as great as Tierney is, as good as Sack has been, and these sort of names, Partey to a degree, we're over-relying on players. You know, we're overplaying players when they need a rest. And I get it. As much as I could sit here, I get it. Because if I'm Arteta, I'd say, Tierney, I hear you need a rest and that. But end of the day, I need 3 points, bro. So we're costing ourselves. So it's that, really.
I mean, it's interesting. I see a thing that it was so many years to the day when we beat Barcelona at the Emirates, obviously, Arshavin and that. And that was the Jack Wilshere show, as people always say. And I read this report where they were saying at the time that doctors were saying to Arsene Wenger, like, you need to manage him a little bit better because of the way his legs are and his injuries, you need to rotate him, where Arsenal were basically picking him every week.
And then he went to Bolton and played forever as well, at a point.
Yeah, and England and everything. So do we have to be careful now? I mean, I'm looking at Tierney, very injury prone since he's been at Arsenal, and he's had multiple injuries as well. He did his shoulder. He's had a few leg injuries. You're then looking at Gabriel Martinelli since coming back. You know, he had a pretty bad knee injury for a teenager. He's been injury prone since coming back. Like, do you think we have to, you know, even with Saka now, I'm thinking about Saka. He's playing every game at the moment. You know, he's like probably the first.
He has had some injuries as well, even.
He's had injury. Do we have to be careful how we play these young players? Because I know, young players want to play every game. You know, they're not going to want to be rested at all. But do we have to manage these players better?
I do think a lot is made of managing players and resting players and things like that. I'm not going to lie. At the end of the day, injuries are a hazard of football and you need to be able to play games. So to a degree, I'm obviously worried about Saka because we're over-relying on him. But to a degree, I'm not. My problem is just a sense of sometimes you might have to save players for themselves from themselves because like as much as I like Tierney, hard as nails, you know, it's a lot's made of about Arsenal fans out in the snow, he's wearing shorts. He wants to play every game. Everyone wants to play every game. So is it a case of like with Partey, we have to save them from themselves where they're you know, I'm not saying they're being evil, but they're saying they're fit. We know deep down they might not be fit. Do we keep them out? You know, could it be something along them lines? Of course, I'm always going to be worried about the young players. Obviously, some of the injuries that has happened have been literally on a football field and have just been unfortunate. It hasn't always been down to Arsenal's medical staff, but it is worrying because injuries happen in football, but some teams get them more than others. And, you know, I'm sure we will look back in May at some point and you will see the list of players and how much they've missed out. Even these players we're not speaking about that might have missed 1 week, 1 month, the next 2 weeks. All this stuff adds up.
Do you know what was Kevin Campbell was on here last week and he said that he didn't like the fact that our young players, he felt like were carrying this team. He said that he felt like experienced players should be leading the youngsters. And then I was trying to refer to him, you know, that class of 92 Man United. Ferguson said those youngsters came through and carried that team and they obviously went and won the title. Is it a problem that our youngsters are being relied upon so heavily or you know, how do you view that they're so important to us?
I mean, we talk about playing young players. Our DNA is about blood in young players and Hey Len and things. So players need to play. I have no problem about that. The problem is when you've got, historically, Arsenal have been underperforming, you know, I don't like to make noise about money, but, you know, money and all of these things. When you see their inconsistencies and you see the players and, you know, above everything, these young players give you hope. It just raises the spotlight negatively on these players. Because imagine, you know, Smith Rowe was at Huddersfield a year or so ago. Why does he get it more than the other players? Why more than Willian, for example? So I would say it's only a problem because our experienced players are the ones making mistakes, being inconsistent and historically underperforming. If we had a platform like City, of course we're not City, but you know, and I'm reaching a bit, but just in principle, they've got Phil Foden and you look to your left, you look to your right, you see Gundogan, you see these sort of guys away from the money. They're players that know how this thing is, so they can get gassed. Our young players are just finding themselves, really. So it doesn't concern me. It does concern me because the players we have are not consistent historically.
It's true what you said because I think the difference is now, if Phil Foden has a quiet game, it's not a problem because Sterling, Gundogan, Aguero, they're going to still win you that game. We're in a situation where if Saka has a poor game, Smith Rowe has a poor game, maybe we lose that game because then Aubameyang's up front, doesn't get no service. No one in midfield, in the middle of midfield, scores goals. So that's the difference for me. I don't have a problem with youngsters, you know, playing all the time and thriving, but we're actually looking at them to consistently win us the games. And I think that's the problem.
And you said it there, bro. And I think the problem is as well, I do think maybe not so much now, but when it was really bad for us as fans, as a club this season, I think players were hiding behind them. I think players historically have hid behind them. You know, we even players that have been scapegoats, people always looking at someone to hide behind. And, you know, I'd say the one good thing amongst everything with these Hey Len players is that it's put the spotlight on these experienced players a bit more, you know. I don't think it's directly correlated to Pepe's form, but it's made, not that Pepe should be the first name to say, but you have to show something now. We're looking at Willian a bit more now, not that we wasn't already. So, you know, I just think it's because it's like people are saying in the chat, it's just because the experienced players are not levels, you know. At best, they're inconsistent. You know, we look at those experienced lads, how many are really certified, and we've probably crossed that blurred line now, Curtis, where, you know, you look at Saka, you look at Tierney, because of age or games played in both their cases, they tie over as being young players relatively and experienced players. You know, how many experienced players would you keep? Like, you're Arteta now, how many are you keeping with your heart? Not he's good and but he can do this, like real team. How many are you keeping?
I'm thinking Aubameyang, Leonard, Tierney. Quite young anyway. Partey's 27, so him. most of the others can go, bro. I'm just all I can think of are the young players.
And that's it. And that's the realest of it, you know. That's it. We're keeping more young players. And that's the answer to it, really, Curtis. Be real.
No, it's true. It's true. I think one of the biggest problems at Arsenal over the past few years is the type of player that we're signing. We don't sign hungry players. We need hungry players. Like, we're signing players and it's like it's a retirement plan for them. You know, you've seen older players go to clubs and thrive before, you know, Zlatan and, you know, I know Ronaldo's an exception.
Thiago Silva. The mentality is different, man.
Thiago Silva's what, 36? He's 3 years older than David Luiz.
It's the mentality that sets him apart.
Yeah, we've got to pick the right kind of players to bring to the club. I think as fans, we've got to forget now just looking for the biggest name, the most expensive signing. The market's overcrowded now. There aren't enough good players in those brackets and we don't have the money. We need the right kind of player.
Fact. You know,
that hunger. For me, Bissouma's a no-brainer this summer. I don't see any reason whatsoever that we can't get that deal done. Unless like a Man City or someone came in for him. That's a player, first of all, I'd be looking at. I like Sabitzer at Leipzig. Got a
very underrated, man.
I would definitely be looking at him. Max Aaron's for me at right back. I'd be looking at him. Lamptey's good as well. Hakimi, if we could get him. The players are there. I feel like the options are there for us. And it's just about being smart in the market.
It's like you said, it's about being smart in the market. It's about being proactive. It's like even today you hear talk about we're ahead of our summer planning and things like that. One has to wonder how much planning you can do without knowing you're going to be in Europe, because we've previously heard we're ready to react for three different scenarios based on last summer. I didn't really see reacting. I saw reactions in terms of, you know, reacting towards we don't know what we're doing with Saliba and things like that. It's like you said, it's for fundamentally for me. I remember you said something on my channel and it always stuck with me. It's like you never get the vibe that, you know, you get the vibe we're signing good players, but you never get the vibe of they're tying into something. It's like we're buying people who are banging on them at the moment. They're good technical footballers, but you don't see how they tie into the system or what we're trying to do. And then lo and behold, beyond the obvious at our club, why they don't thrive, or why, you know, we're saying do this and do that. And the third, man, you know, is even if you, for me, the problem is not getting Bissouma. You know, I want Bissouma, but I'm an Arsenal fan as are you. So we know we don't get targets. Make sure you have 3-4 of them names, you know, because like you see when Partey's not there, we praise Partey for his passes. Correct me if I'm wrong, people, but he's there fundamentally to put a foot in. If he's not there, it's long for us. You know, you need depth. Even now, based on the games we're playing, you see how strong depth is. With Liverpool, it's they're relevant to this. You see how strong depth would be in one thing, but also quality depth. So until we right our wrongs and learn in hindsight and apply better foresight, me and you are going to be sitting on YouTube saying the same old things. It's as simple as that.
Bro, you made a great point there. How often do Arsenal buy the player that we're usually linked with that summer? You know, I remember Benzema, so many summers we've been signing Benzema. You know, I remember one time I was on holiday, right? I was in Spain and Higuain was meant to be signing for us. This when he was leaving Real Madrid. And I was reading something in Spain and it was all over the news saying Higuain, they've agreed terms, the deal's done.
It was wavy. You was in Spain hearing that Spanish base as well.
Gonzalo Higuain, this when he was a gunman as well, you know. Next minute. Jeez. Days later, I came home. I've turned on Sky Sports. Higuain's holding up a Napoli scarf. I'm like, hey, what's going on here? Like, I thought the deal was done, bro. Next
week, he's come back to London on a wavy team.
Bro, I came back thinking Gonzalo was up front, you know. And next minute, I think he went and signed Lucas Perez or someone. I was like, bro, I don't even know who Donny is from. Like, I've seen him on FIFA a couple of times and I don't know who this guy is. Arsenal, man, Yanam, Villa, Draxler, Higuain, you know, how many? Oh, man.
Them paper talk names there. We're still linked to Draxler to this day, to be honest with you.
Yeah, he's a fan in that one. We'll probably go and buy him in the summer when he's washed up. You know, we do this, man. Arsenal are a mad club. I don't know if you saw what Arsene Wenger was saying at the weekend. I mean, I've got to the point with Wenger now. When I see him in interviews, I look at him like a politician now. Like, you're just saying whatever to just, you know, please people now. When he brought that book out, I genuinely thought, you know what, Arsene? Put all those wrongs right.
You know he's too much of a gentleman for that, man.
Tell us that your hands were tied, man. Tell us that you didn't want to sell them players and you didn't have the money. And the man just, he did the cover-up job for the Cronkies in the book. And I just thought at that point, for me, you know, people have been saying, does Wenger deserve a statue, this, that, the other? I'm not sure he does, bro.
I can't lie, I'm Wenger FC, man. Listen, he needed to step down, but I think he needs a statue. I think he needs everything. I know they do a lot of wrongs, man. Everyone in life does a lot of wrongs, Curtis, but... It's Wenger, man. Like, I watched all them interviews. You know what it is? I don't know what Wenger does to you. He's beaky, but you can be... I remember him, when he managed us, I'd be so angry at Arsene Wenger. And then I'd just hear him talk, and I'm like, all right, man, I'm not even vexed anymore.
Wenger, isn't it? His uncle Wenger. We love him. I don't know, man. Maybe give him a stand, man. Name a stand after him or something, man. But you know what it is? He is a legend, you know. Of course he's a legend. What he did at the start is unbelievable. But the way he did things at the end, I can never understand how he was turned like that. You know, that's what I can't get my head around.
That's where it went wrong for me, bro.
I feel like Highbury Wenger was just a winner. He was ruthless. He was doing anything to out.
First guy to come and give Ferguson some madness. Do you remember when we... Remember the good days? Wenger used to have a better head-to-head against Alex Ferguson in this football team. Relative, like...
Blowing up the place.
Bro. I just think where Wenger fell off, for me in particular, beyond the obvious, I'd say for me, the last 4 or 5 years of his reign or 3 to 5 year period, I really had a problem seeing if he was making the right decision for Arsenal or what he feels at the time. It's like, I remember when I really started to look at you like, you can't do this anymore, as much as I love you. When he gave Coquelin, Giroud and Elneny new deals, I think Elneny's riding off that deal to this day. I was thinking, hold on a minute. And then you've tried to sell half with them. It ain't making sense, man. It's a madness.
You know what it is? It's an Uncle Wenger thing, I'm telling you. When I see him, I think, yo, man, you're proper Arsenal still. But
yeah,
it just pains me what happened in that last 10 years and all the lies in the press conferences. You know, every transfer window, or if we can find a player that improves the squad. And you're like, half of Europe improves our squad, bro. We're like, we had
to this day.
You know what I mean? To this day, we're still trying to sort out the mess he left us in. I don't get how he changed so much. You were the best. With Ferguson, he was...
That, man. And he had a lot of wrong-ins around him. See what killed Wenger? I think if you was to ask Wenger where he went good and bad, I'd say probably his trust in people. That's the biggest lesson I've learned with Wenger for my life, is that he puts too much trust in people. When you got the people of the mentality of Thierry and these players who stand up to be counted, who don't want to do you wrong, in his previous years, it's a madness. I think he should have stepped down in 2014. That was the perfect time. Or even when we beat Chelsea again, and we beat them in the FA Cup, I think that was the best chance to step down. Like Broads is saying, Glazidis and Demande were... They're wrong-ins, innit? I got more time for Wenger than each and every one of them. Wenger had a lot wrong. And you know what it is with Wenger? He enjoyed the comfortability of this football club, again, because of the people above him. I think fundamentally, if we had owners who gave a crap, or if we had David Dean who used to save my man from his madness at times, we'd be better, man. But instead, me and you here on YouTube talking about the glory days, man. So right.
People are on to me in the comments. You know what? All right, cool.
They're on to you. What they said?
We put Wenger up there still for the first 10 years. I let him off. But do you know what? I'm not going to lie. That man pained me, you know, as a fan. That man brought some serious... And do you know why he pained me so much? Because as much as I criticise people like Arteta and that now, I know the circumstances that Arteta's working with. So you're struggling as a manager, but you're a new manager. You're figuring things out. Wenger knew this game inside out. And he just played a role that I couldn't get my head around. I feel like Wenger couldn't accept the money in football. He was like,
yeah, he couldn't.
It wasn't like this 10 years ago.
Exactly.
He wasn't willing to adjust to it. It was like, bro,
survive, bro.
You got to move with it, man. The money's part of the game now, bro. You got to spend.
That's it. And we thought FFP was going to save us. We thought all of these things. We didn't adapt. All the other things are wrong. For me as well, one thing I would say about him and our scouting team, if we know we want to do this Avengers thing and combat the evil that is spending, let's make sure we do this thing when it comes to finding these next stars. Because that's the one thing about Wenger. When we moved to the Emirates, especially in recent years, now we're seeing Mbappe, Dembele, all heap of guys, people. We ain't got none of that. Like we didn't get no one. Like, we got Sonogo. Shout out to Sonogo for his banter things. But like, that's it, man. I think Wenger had done a lot wrong, but I think he was done dirty. And I think where I'm cool with Wenger is fundamentally, I know you was warped about it, but you tried to go about, you wanted us to be the club, innit? You just went a bit mad. He was ultimately too stubborn. And like you said, my man didn't want to adapt, bro. Didn't want to adapt.
I let him off. He brought a lot of joy to us still. So we'll give him the statue still, but I won't forget, man. I think like someone said there, he got too involved with the boardroom. You know, a manager.
The lines got blurred, 100.
They were blurred, fam. Like, he was talking about how much money we've earned this year. And, you know, I was like, bruv, just, we ain't even got a CDM for 10 years. Don't worry about how much money we're earning. You haven't replaced Vieira in 15 years, bruv.
But do you know what I give Wenger? He was a bit of a football fortune teller at times, man. Because I do think a lot of things he used to say, I'm seeing it. Like, it's a bit weird. I'll be watching football and I'll randomly hear Wenger's voice in my head, pause. And he'll say things like, one about the full thing, like where he got killed for saying it's a trophy. And I don't defend it. But looking back now, it's like, I'd give anything to go back to them days. And man. Like, I give anything, bro.
I remember we used to finish fourth. I was vexed. You know,
I used to be vexed. Like, we should be doing more. Like,
I weren't making content them times. If I was making content, I would have been like, fourth, he's a disgrace. Like, fourth ain't good enough. You know what I mean? Right now, if we finish fourth,
get him out, Robbie.
I'll be popping bottles on screen with you, bro, if we made fourth right now.
But trust me, and that's sad, man. Ultimately, Wenger died in footballing senses. Wenger died by the high standards I feel he set, man, and he just didn't adapt. And I just feel his lesson is just not to put too much trust in people and have the right people around you. Because as soon as David Dean went, amongst other things, bro, we're seeing what a football club is today, innit? Like, you don't need to expand. It's so, it's sad, man. I feel like drinking some Henny or something nice. I might as well like talk about what my team's on now.
Wenger left us in a mess, you know. It's sad still. It's sad because the thing is, you know, the first year we came out the Champions League, I actually think he would have won the Europa League that year. It was just unlucky that Atletico had a nightmare. And
that again, Koscielny messed up over them two legs, if I remember.
Yeah. And the funny thing is, I remember when we got Atletico, I thought, yo, man, maybe we're gonna struggle here. And I remember I went to the game at the Emirates and we battered them, bro. Mm. I think it was Oblak. He made about seven saves that day, and quality. I was like, that game should have been over. And then Koscielny makes the mistake. Griezmann, game over. Wenger would have probably won that Europa League. He'd still probably be at the club. But I always look back. I always think the Luis Suarez deal.
Yeah, but that weren't even him, though. Like, sometimes I think he got blamed.
He's part of it, though, DG. I reckon he's in there with Gazidis.
It's Arsenal people trying to be cheeky. That's it. That's one thing I'm getting on to Wenger, because by all means, take the blame. But don't always take the blame for ish that isn't you, man. Like, I hear what you're saying, though. Ultimately, he's part of the buck and, you know, you got to tarnish them with the same brush. But it's a madness, man. It's, how can such a great man end like that, man? It's like, I didn't think it. You know what? It's almost like you knew he would leave one day, but couldn't see it, man, in the distant future. It's like, I hope that we one day could talk about historically Arsenal and things like that, but in a nice way. But right now, bro, we're mad.
Wenger should have left at the top, man. Like, you've been that great. Leave at the top, man. He got left being hounded out of the football club. And when you look at Ferguson, left Man United as a Premier League champion. He won the league and said, thanks a lot, I'm done. Let me go out on top of the game. Mm-hmm. This guy, he was moving like Mike Tyson when he was still trying to fight for peas, and Danny Williams is knocking him out on Channel 5. It's like, bro, man, I don't want to remember that boxer, bro. I want to remember the real elite fighter, bro.
That's what I said. 2014, he should have kept it moving, man. 2014 is when he should have kept it moving. Definitely against Chelsea. But that's the thing, Wenger, I think what didn't help Wenger in the end is that he loves football too much. Like, he's not, like, I'm sure Ferguson loves football, but you get the impression Sir Alex Ferguson knows there's other things to life. I got other things. Wenger obviously knows that, but that's all him. It's all him. And Arsenal gave him that platform in that you could never see him getting sacked until what obviously unfolded. So, man, it's crazy, man. But I respect that manager for what he
did. You can get the statue still, but you owe us an apology for the last 10 years still. You know what I mean? Now, listen, before we get out of here, I just wanted to do this quick. Yeah, I want to
go on.
I want to know what you think right now our best team is, because we got a lot of situations. I mean, I thought Odegaard played well the other day. For a guy that has not played a lot of football, I think he will get better as he gets fitter as well. He was already talking in the interview after the game about potentially joining on a permanent. So, you know, well.
Let's see how it goes, Odegaard, man. I like you. I want you to stay. We need that. But let's see how it goes, man. Everyone says everything when things are going wavy for them.
Yeah,
Let's
see in May. So, me and you are picking the team today. Europa League final. We've got Man United in the final. We've got to pick our best 11. I want you to tell me right now what you think Arsenal's best team is. All right, you know, like when you're on it, I'll put you on the spot.
Yeah, I'm trying to think because I'm getting a madness. All right, cool. Let's go with in goal. Let's go with the easiest decision, bro. You know who it is, Leno.
Yeah, it's Leno in goals. It already gets tricky, bruv.
You know what? Right now, I'm gonna go with recency biased, and I'm gonna say right back Cedric.
Yeah,
I'm gonna go with that one still.
I don't mind that.
Tierney obviously picks himself at left back.
Tierney picks himself.
You said final, right?
Yeah, this is the final, bruv. Pick the team. What's our best?
David Luiz Gabriel,
it just seems to be a partnership that works, doesn't it?
It's that as well, but you said final. I'm like, you know what, David Luiz, the one time you're on crud is a cup final, so you're the guy for today. You put me on the spot, man. I'm trying to avoid the hardest decision, which is the free. Partey picks himself.
I want Danny next to him.
I would have some bias as well, you know. He's just telling me Xhaka.
So I'm telling you, Xhaka. Why?
Give me a sec. We're going too quick.
I might be the team at that speed, you know.
Final Xhaka. Tobias, I'd rather the Partey's thing, but the final thing you said is getting me.
You're going granite, yeah?
And Xhaka's one of them guys. Do you know what it is? It's just a mentality thing. It should be Tobias, but you said final, bro, and I can't get that one out of my head. So I'm looking at guys that kind of get it. You know, he told fans to F off. He gets it. he gets it 100%. He gets it.
VAR.
Changing for Ceballos. I'm taking it to VAR, man. you gasped me. You deleted my brain. I can't see anything other than Ceballos. It's a bias thing.
Granite could cost you the final, you know. He could get red card.
You see what I'm saying? You're corrupting it now. It's gone to VAR. Ceballos, you've been in the week into this final. Ceballos has been trading well. He's convinced me. It's a Ceballos team right now. This is very tricky, man. I can't lie.
Real tricky. Come on, then. Talk to me. Number 10. Are you still Smith Rowe in the 10 over Odegaard?
Let me get to it, bro. I'm trying to think. it's peak. Who are we playing? Man United.
Man United, man. Europa League final.
Smith Rowe, I'll give it to you, my brother. Smith Rowe.
He's earned it, Annie. We haven't seen enough of Odegaard.
It should be, but this is hard. This is difficult. If you put me on the spot like this again, I'm busting out. who should I go now?
Oh, surely he's on the right, isn't he?
Man United center half, Maguire in that. Saka on the right.
Yeah.
It's difficult because there's two men that probably got to get left out.
So we're picking here out of what?
I'm going to buckle under pressure. Aubameyang's going to have to do a job left wing for me. He's going to have to. He has to, bro.
His picture ain't even come up. He can't believe you picked him on the left.
Nah, he has to do that for me, fam. And then I have to go with Lacazette through the middle still. I have to. I feel sorry for Pepe. I feel sorry for Martinelli. I don't even feel right about doing this, man. I wish 13 players could play. 14 players or something.
United's
not going forward with Aubameyang there. Saka's doing his thing against Luke Shaw. Lacazette, that hold-up play. Martinelli, you'll be on after 60 minutes. Odegaard, you'll be on after 60 for Smith Rowe. Xhaka, you get a little 10-5. I'm not really convinced with a couple. I don't know, man. You know, you're never really going to be convinced if it's not Saka.
Yeah.
If it's not Saka or Tini or Gabriel or Partey, I'm not really convinced about anyone. Big up Smith Rowe as well.
It's a tricky one, isn't it? It is a tricky one.
What's yours, then?
Me, I'm playing Aubameyang up front, and I'm playing Pepe on the left.
That's the, I feel sorry for letting Pepe out. You see what I'm saying? Like, I hear that. I'm for that as well. Yo, bad guy. I'm not doing this with you again, man, because I don't know.
Okay, he's gone, bro. He said, what? Left wing? I've just scored a hat-trick. I'm not even showing up.
It goes out to the left wing anyways, man. Just do a job for me, man. Yeah. But see, I'm even on that. That's a solid team for me. You know, I wouldn't change a thing.
That's a good team, man.
But then again, you know, would you say that's a team good enough to get top four? If we, if the team, the way we're playing now, if we started again in August, like August is tomorrow, does that get top four for you?
I don't think it does. I don't think it does. I think you look at Cedric and David Luiz, they're doing a job. They're not good enough. They wouldn't get in any other top six team, in my opinion. None of them two, really. You can't have half a defence that can probably get picked off against the top players. So, no, I don't think so. With the problem with Arsenal, you got too many inconsistent players in the team. Sabias is a world beater 1 week. The next week is spinning round and round. You got Pepe, like, inconsistent as well. Even Aubameyang sometimes up front against a low block, it don't happen.
It's like you said, bro. It's like you don't know. It's like the only ones I'm really convinced with in that lineup is Saka, Partey, Tini, really and truly, and Gabriel. Like, let me ask you a controversy one. You know, if you could imagine your back, like, just the back line, if you could imagine that, in fact, the whole team, if you could imagine that whole team in the image you want, and like, let's say it could get top four, yeah, focusing on Leno now, would you replace Leno?
I would say no, only because a keeper that I would consider better than him, I think number one would be expensive. And I think...
No, but would you move for it though? Like, you know, let's just say, take it one step further. Let's assume the bench, you know, you've got all the depth. You've got a competent 11. Do you look at replacing Leno, maybe making him number two? Because it's something I fight with.
Yeah, I know. You've brought this up many times about Leno.
More agenda. I'm trying to flip the script where you was moving mad.
Yeah, we might have to end this shortly, you know. No, do you know what, man? I look at Leno, I think, do you know what? Since the day he joined Arsenal, he's never had a good back four in front of him.
That's one thing I give him. And I always say, I feel sorry for him.
Liverpool, pull out a couple of good defenders, all of a sudden, the so-called best goalkeeper in the league looks a mess. So to me, I'll be patient with Leno. Give him a good back four and then I'll fully judge him. I think he's improved this year as well.
Yeah, no, you have to give him his flowers. That's one thing. I think he's only made two glaring mistakes. Other than that, he's been good. I think his distribution, something that I found good but shaky, he's improved. I think vocally he's improved. I'm all for it. It's just I always ask myself, as much as I like Leno, is he competent enough to do beyond being a top four keeper and a potential world beater? Because, you know, I like him, but the things I praise him for, you should be a good shot stopper. And sometimes his shot stopping puts it in areas where people in problems, but I wouldn't really look to replace him. It's just something I always fight with myself and wonder with it.
Is he the standard? I would say then, just quickly, if we're looking at top four next season, I would say Luiz, Cedric, Ceballos. What do you think? Are you happy with Smith Rowe being Arsenal's out and out number 10, or would you still try and upgrade him? Would you look at a Sabitzer or a, you know, how do you look at that position?
I think Smith Rowe's he's got to that level now where you're part of the squad. You know, there's no romance to it now. It's like, is this, even with Saka and these players, I think, as much as, you know, I'm not saying overcrowd these positions, but I think fans forget how real this is. At the end of the day, their job is to be footballers, prove you shouldn't be on the bench. And it just seems like Arsenal fans are scared of competition. Obviously, there's still question marks with Smith Rowe. Can you continue? Can you do it next season when there's expectation? Now we expect you to do it. But I think he's earned that right where you're involved in the club. You know, I'm all for always getting better. If you can find better than Smith Rowe in that 10 position, why not? Me personally, I'm not going to lie. My opinion's changed a bit. I'm all for if you could find a 10, if Odegaard could be permanent. But I must admit, with Smith Rowe's emergence in that role now, I'm more kind of want to double down on a number 8, because you know yourself, as well as a number 10, you can get a creative number 8. I think well with that. And like you said earlier, if you could grab a Basuma or a 6, I think you need two midfielders. I think this Arsenal team need two midfielders, because the man to the left, Partey, sadly, he's been a bit of a flight risk. When he's not fit, it's peak. We're back to square one. And again, depth, For me, I would like to see two midfielders minimum. You fail to get that, then I don't think we can do serious things next season. Even if I might be wishing a bit, but even if somehow Joe Willock or someone comes back a 10 times better player, it's got to get solved. I don't think we have the depth there. I think there's too many question marks. Arguably, you could say, based on next season, this is how it is, because there's still a question mark over who is going to be that centre-half, who is going to be that right-back. Ceballos, Odegaard, them and there are not permanent. Xhaka will probably be here, but he's always linked with moves away. So it's a bit of a mad one still.
I think definitely these three positions. I mean, can Saliba come back and fill that? I don't know. Do we need a more experienced centre-back? I think right-back is... one of the top priorities in the summer's got to be right back.
This is why I like talking about football with you, because you get it. This is what I'm telling people. We need a right. Everyone can see it, but you need, the same way we're not talking about, we haven't mentioned Tierney's name once, really and truly, because we've got it. We need that on the right hand side. I like Cedric. I want Cedric to prove he can be the man. We've got him in the club already, but I don't know if you're going to be on it for 38 games. You need to show me from now to the end of the season.
If I said to you now, 30 mil. Right back in the summer. Who? What name are you thinking of first? Or give me one or two names if you got.
You're on the spot. That's a difficult one. You sold me earlier with the Hakimi one. That's probably the dream chasing.
Yeah.
I'd probably double down for Lamptey. I'd really try aggressively to bring Lamptey to this club. Really aggressively to bring him to this football club. If we're keeping it a homegrown.
20 years of age at Brighton, man. That deal should be doable, really, shouldn't it?
Yeah. Like, I like Max Aarons. And I think he's probably indirectly got one foot out the door because Norwich strike you as more of a sellable club or more negotiable for a club. But I'd probably go with Lamptey, man. Lamptey probably be it for me.
Would he? And what about centre-back? I mean, I know we've dreamed of Upamecano for ages. He's gone to Bayern. We need an experienced defender, like a 26, 27-year-old.
You see, for me, I'd rather... obviously, I'd love a world-class player. I'd love Skriniar, Jimenez, all of these sort of guys. The best centre-halves in the world. But I genuinely feel there's something in the same way nobody knew about Pablo Mari within reason. Can't we just scout someone that can be that bridge player, that experienced player, that 26 to 29 years of age? Because we overcomplicate football sometimes. These lot are paid to scout. You watch whole heap of football, COVID times, it's even more footage. Can't you just find a centre-half that ticks the attributes we want? First and foremost, can you defend? Can you hold your position? The right temperament, you know, Gabriel's got bravery about him. We kind of need that too. And a calmer influence. I don't think it has to be a big... Of course, I would love to, you know, we could talk about all the names, but I think that could be a scouting thing. You could just get that done. That bridge player so that we can... The door's still open for Saliba to eventually nail that role down if it isn't to be immediately.
Would you take I don't know, like a Lewis Dunk or someone like that, or
I think there's deals to be done in the Prem still. You know, I'd have to sit down. I think there's a couple centre halves, but again, the thing with them, man, there is like you can't even get deals like that in the Prem. Too tough now, really and truly. It's like everyone knows you got bans, really, or you want to take our place or pay a bit more.
And I suppose if we're looking at, see, the only reason I said Aarons, I think because
I like Aarons still
because they're in the Championship. I just think that it would be a bit cheaper than Lamptey.
Probably would, but they've said no. But the thing is, with Norwich, like Norwich have said they're not selling their players, like they've got Lewis gone, but Godfrey's gone. They know they'll make their cake, man. So I think that's even them being in the Championship, bro. Look how much Benrahma and Watkins went. I think you know it's almost big clubs are getting calmer now because the smaller clubs in the Prem, quote unquote, the Championship clubs, they've got peas. You know, foreign clubs are stealing your young players now. It's fully calmer now, it's fully calmer.
This position here, is it still our for you? Is that the one you'd still love to get?
Man, don't. I kind of calmed down and accepted. You're going to get me starting the vids and them things again.
Yeah, man. Yeah, I see Deluded tomorrow. Our to Arsenal.
You're going to get me. He's already in my Football Manager team. I forgot about him, but that'll be it for me still. That'll be my one. Number one target, even though it's a myth.
I don't think it's going to happen, is it? But it would be good, man. Him on part. And then the centre back one. See,
even
for me,
like Odegaard permanently. I can't lie, I whisper it, but a little hoping for it to, you know, if this can, it's only been 30 seconds, but hoping.
Yo, I'm not going to lie. And then, you know, Arsenal fans were our own worst enemies, but I saw things in Odegaard that I liked, man. I thought, you know what? I'm not saying buy him yet, but I feel like he can.
We're slags for technical footballers, man. Let's be honest. The minute we see technical footballers at Arsenal, we're ready. And somebody said even Grevenbeck, that could be a magnificent target. I can't lie, I might be. Do you know what my biggest dream chasing signing would be?
Go on.
Camavinga. Dream chasing. I know it's dream chasing, but contracted until 2022. Looks like he's got one foot out the door. Small hope, man, that it could get done. French and that. Musk can say something. Would you say?
He's being linked with moves, isn't he? I saw it.
Madrid and them things there. That's what I said. It's dream chasing. But I would love Camavinga. That'd be the one.
That would be a good one. That would be a good one. I got to be honest. I think Aouar is another one where the dream's gone.
Yeah, fully.
I think that was last summer. I think this summer he goes to a PSG or someone.
I'd bring back Benassia if worse comes to worse. But again, that one's gone. I would look at bringing back Benassia from AC Milan. I'd look at that. I think he played well in that box-to-box role. I think it might be... Do you remember what I was saying earlier where you can look at a player and you're not too sure if this is the year? But I would say Kakare from Lyon as well. I watched a lot of him as a kid and he's getting better. I'd say that, really. What's the lad as well, man? We probably can't get him, but... What's that French lad? He was at Gladbach and he went by Munich and he's doing iffy at Marseille. Cossans, that's his name. I can't spell that name, so I don't know how you're going to get that up there. But yeah, him.
Yeah, like, I got no chance of that one.
Glitch. I would like Gravenberch from Ajax, though. He is young.
He's good.
Champions League. He's seasoned, man. I think he can develop into a goal-scoring midfielder. Somebody said it in the comments and I think we've done him injustice, man. Guendouzi.
Yeah. I mean, I'm happy to bring him back. Me, I just hope he's grown up. Like, as I've said a few times, he's having a kid. He's playing every week in Germany. You just hope he comes back a more mature guy. But I think Fabrizio said the other day that Arsenal are open to him coming back. The problem you've got, he's got a year left on his deal. So do you give him a contract the second he walks back through the door? Because you can't let him go into the last year.
I can't lie, I probably would because, you know, do you actually remember before the madness happened, there was talk like of signing a new deal actually at Arsenal and it kind of went quiet for a bit and then obviously events unfolded. I think one thing you need to do is make a decision. You need to know what you're doing with Matteo Guendouzi now. It's been like, a significant part of the season. You first things first would be keep him at the football club. You can, you fight for a place next season. You sign a new deal when we move forward. If not, hopefully signs a new deal, goes out on loan, protects our resale value. If not, what needs to be done is he might turn into a 40, 50 million pound player, but we just might have to make our little 20 million eat on it because what we've paid 7 or 8 million, put a little sell on clause. But one thing that needs to do is a decision. What I don't want to see is him wearing the summer, midway through the summer. Is Guendouzi staying or not? Is Torreira staying or not? Is Saliba being part of the team or going on loan? What's happening with Mavropanos? I know, obviously, you can't get things done all the time, but we need to... I just want to see proactiveness. That's one thing we've been lacking, man.
Yeah, no, it's true. Me, personally, I would definitely bring Guendouzi back and I wouldn't even mind giving him a new contract. He's a lot better player than Elneny. He's better on the ball than Xhaka. He's only 21. For me, that's a no-brainer. I would sell Torreira. Torreira doesn't want to be in England.
That's fundamentally it for me with Torreira. Just because I would love Torreira to stay, but he don't want to be here. Simple as that.
He don't want to be here. I'd sell Elneny as well. I mean, someone here, Billy's saying, what about Renato Sanchez? I know he did well at Lille. I'm not sure how he's done this season. I know he had a good season last year.
You can look at it, but probably skip that one still. He's a good player, though.
Just briefly looking at this, does anything tell you that you would like to sign a player in the front four somewhere? I'm still dreaming of Wilfred Zaha being here, you know, on this side.
It just turns into that territory, innit? I mean, it's a bit weird because the front four positions, it's like what Wenger said, you know, to quote him, unless it's super players, I don't really want it. You know, I don't want to keep doing the William thing unless there's someone that you can find someone that's a genuine threat to Saka's position, to Pepe's position, to Aubameyang's position, a long-term striker or someone that threatens Smith Rowe and can be rotated. Unless you can do that, I don't think we should be signing players. Obviously, you can't forget Martinelli's involved in these sort of shouts. I'd love Nelson to get back in these conversations, whether it happens or not. But only players that are going to really put problems. You know, man are saying Grealish in the comments. Of course, I'd love Grealish, but that's a dream. Grealish and Camavinga would be lit, but it's a madness.
Yeah, man. Yeah, we'll have to see what happens. A long way to go this season anyway. So let's see. Trust a lot me. Of it will be down to what competition we're in. Let's be honest. If we're somehow in the Champions League, you never know. Maybe they look at Grealish and them, man. But if we're in Europa League or maybe not even in Europe.
Forget it.
Forget it, mate. It's not happening. We'll be on the TK Maxx sale rack again, looking for the cheap bargains, bro. Hoping it's
random Ralph Lauren hoodie or something.
You're not even sure if it's real or not. You
don't know if it fits you.
You know what I mean? It's an extra large, but you just got to pattern it somehow already.
Tucking it in and just telling people to pull it up and that. Did it,
you know, it's all mad. Nah, big up, man. Look, over 900 people in here. Make sure you subscribe. Hit the like button. Subscribe to Deluded as well. We'll be back on your channel Thursday.
Thursday around 12 o'clock, people. That's all you need to know. Just make sure you're making a mental note of that. You know, we'll be there. And we'll be talking about, you know, Benfica, the game, and any other talking points in relation to that, man.
Yeah, man. What you got going on today? Anything else?
I'm thinking of doing a watch along for the Champions League. I'm not too sure yet. So, you know, have a look at other butchers. You might see me, you might not. Apart from that, I've kind of done my videos for today. So it's just, yeah, literally the live stream I've done today and that sort of content there, really, my guy. What about yourself?
Yeah, again, as I said before, man, I've been doing the live stream. Some people are asking for the Champions League. So I might do the PSG Barca game, but look out for it. If not, then we'll be back. We'll be back tomorrow at 2 p.m. anyway. But yeah, big up everyone for tuning in. Big up my guy, Deluded. Appreciate you coming on, bruv.
Love having me, man.
I'll be back tomorrow, people. Well, possibly PSG Barcelona.